On behalf of the Church of St. Clement, we welcome you, really, a heartfelt and genuine praise the Lord. We get to be together in this place. For all those online, we welcome you. We're glad to be celebrating our Lord this morning together. Let's begin with a word of prayer. Oh Lord God, We, your people, worship and praise your holy name and say thank you and glory to you for being our risen Lord. We pray that everything we think and say and do this morning would be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Amen. Please stand. Hallelujah! Christ is risen!
The Lord is risen indeed! Hallelujah!
Hallelujah! Christ is risen!
The Lord is risen indeed!
Hallelujah! Christ is risen!
The Lord is risen indeed!
Hallelujah! Almighty God, unto whom all hearts are open, all desires are known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, who through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life, grant that we, who celebrate with joy the day of the Lord's resurrection, may by your life-giving Spirit be delivered from sin and raised from death through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated for our readings.
Today's psalm is Psalm 118. Let us read it in unison. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercy endures forever. Let Israel now proclaim, his mercy endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. There is a sound of exaltation and victory in the tents of the righteous. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. The right hand of the Lord is exalted. The right hand of the Lord has triumphed. I shall not die, but live and declare the works of the Lord. The Lord has punished me sorely, but he did not hand me over to death. Open for me the gates of righteousness. I will enter them. I will offer thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. He who is righteous may enter. I will give thanks to you, for you answered me and have become my salvation. The same stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. On this day, the Lord has acted. We will rejoice and be glad in it. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. So Peter opened his mouth and said, "Truly, I understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. As for the word that he sent to Israel, preaching good news and of peace through Jesus Christ, he is the Lord of all. You yourselves know what happened throughout all of Judea, beginning from Galilee after the baptism that John proclaimed, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him up on the third day and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. And he commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one appointed by God to be judge of the living and the dead. To him all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name." The word of the Lord.
Please stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Thank you. The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. John. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb. We do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb, and as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Does everyone have a seat? We have some in the front. If you're willing to walk down the aisles, we got a few. Well, happy Easter, everyone.
Happy Easter.
Hallelujah. Christ is risen.
Lord, is risen indeed.
Our reading today from the book of Acts took place some time after Jesus' resurrection. In fact, it was more than 40 days after that when he appeared to all his disciples, and then he was ascended. As a matter of fact, it was even after 50 days after the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit was poured out on the disciples. Peter was called to come to the house of a Gentile, a centurion in the Roman army of the Italian cohort, we read. And this man had had a vision of an angel who said that God had heard his prayers and seen his offerings that he had given for the poor, and told him to go call a man in a town called Joppa, whose name was Peter. And so he sent some of his soldiers to go find Peter, and they found Peter, and simultaneously, Peter had gone up on the roof to pray, and I guess that was the thing, you know. And he went up there to pray. He had a vision. He also had a vision. As a matter of fact, three times he saw a big sheet come down from heaven, and there were animals in it. And God said, "Rise, Peter, kill and eat." And he said, "I have never eaten anything unclean." And God said, "You shall not call unclean what I have made clean." And then there was a knock on the door from the centurion's soldiers. He said, "We're here for a guy named Peter." I'm like, "Are you arresting me?" No. And they told him the story. And so he does something no Jew of that day would ever do. He invites them to stay in his house. They weren't allowed to come in to a Jewish home. Peter invites them in. Why? Because of the vision. It wasn't about animals. It was about people. And Peter goes with him the next day to Cornelius' house. He finds that Cornelius has invited all his friends and his family to hear what Peter has to say. They're waiting there, excited, because they've heard about this vision. They want to know what it is that Peter is going to say. And we heard in our gospel, in our reading from the book of Acts. So I want you to keep that in front of you in your bulletin, because I'm gonna refer to it. Peter opens his mouth and preaches very succinctly, at least what we have in Acts. Maybe it probably went on longer than this, but here's a summation. With a Gentile audience, Peter makes 5 points. First, he says, God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him and does what is right is acceptable to him. This is truly an announcement of good news, of wonderful news, to those Gentiles who had recognized that the God of Israel was the one true God, but they weren't part of the covenant. The covenant was made with Abraham and his descendants. And so now they understood. The God of Israel was welcoming all nations into his fold, into his covenant made with Jesus' blood. Second, Peter assumes that the Gentiles there with him know all about Jesus. You say, well, how could they know about Jesus? They didn't have the internet back then. Everyone in the whole country, the area of Judea, the area of Galilee, everyone knew about Jesus. You think of all the miracles that he did. I mean, you know, when Jesus, skipping to after the resurrection, Jesus is, the resurrected Lord is walking with some of his disciples. They don't know it's him. And he's playing coy about what's happened. and pretending like he doesn't know. And they say, "Are you the only one in Jerusalem who doesn't know what happened to Jesus of Nazareth?" And so Peter can assume everyone has known what's been going on for 3 whole years with miracles and healings. And so he says, "You know what happened." Because Jesus' life and his ministry were very public. His death was as public as you could have. And everyone knew about it. And this is how he describes Jesus' ministry in kind of an elevator speech. They didn't have elevators, you know, but if you had to describe in 20 seconds who Jesus is to somebody, this might be a good way to start. God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. He went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we are witnesses of all that he did, both in the country of the Jews and in Jerusalem. That's it. That's Peter, the lead apostle's explanation of who Jesus is. Jesus, of course, was known for 2 things apart from his authoritative and rather radical teaching. He was known for his compassion. We read in the scripture that he had compassion on the people and looked at them as sheep without a shepherd. And he had come to be their shepherd. And he was known for healing people. And that's what got so much attention. Blind people, a man born blind who had never seen, not just lost his sight, who had never seen. People raised from the dead, including Lazarus, who had been in the tomb for 3 whole days. Many countless healings. I would expect that probably, given the size of Jerusalem back at that time, probably everybody knew somebody that had been healed by Jesus. It wasn't very big. And so the Bible says Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He's still showing compassion. He's still healing. This morning, Faria Mulato is going to share her testimony about how God dramatically healed her a few years ago. And again, thank you, Faria, for sharing this very personal story. When she was a child, her mother desperately wanted her to play the violin. Faria had her first recital when she was in 6th grade. She got her music degrees in both education and performance. She taught music and played in the symphony. And then she married a man who had the same passion for music that she did, Daniel, who was also a prof. And after 40 years of playing, about the year 2000, and about the time Daniel was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, she developed carpal tunnel syndrome in her wrist. It became so bad she couldn't play the violin anymore. And she didn't play for nearly 20 years. I still remember Daniel singing in our choir and coming to church and struggling with great effort just so he could attend church. And he went to be with the Lord a few years ago. But as his health was failing, her heart's desire was to play the violin again, not to teach, not to perform, but to play for God in his church.
When the doctor told me I had carpal tunnel, I did the investigation on whether or not I should have the surgery. I decided against it. And I went for 20 years basically just teaching and not playing. And then when I came here to El Paso, I did try to play a hymn, thinking I might be able to play a hymn, but it did hurt so much to play, to put my fingers on the strings, that I really felt I could no longer play, period. I did go to a prayer meeting, not because of that, but I happened to be at one, and I prayed, and I said, "Dear God, I can't play anymore. If you want to close the door on this, I understand. I know you'll open another door, and whatever you decide is fine." So I went home, and honestly, every day after that, my hands felt different, because before I couldn't even hold a pitcher and I couldn't wring a dish towel. But little by little, my hands were changing. I could wring a dish towel, I could hold a pitcher of water. So then 2 weeks later, I picked up my violin. I said, maybe I can play. And I could, and it didn't hurt. I didn't play great, but I thought, wow, maybe God has healed me. I mean, that's the only way I can explain it. That God did heal me enough so that I can play for church. That's what I want to do. I want to play for church.
Third, well, I'll just say this. God's still healing people. He's still healing people. There are many testimonies in this very room, including myself, of people who have been healed physically or emotionally or in some spiritual way. And so He's still doing that. So I want to get to the third point. Peter gets to the very heart of the good news with his audience. He says, "They put Jesus to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third and made him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who had been chosen by God as witnesses, who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead." The death and resurrection of Jesus Christ is what sets Christianity apart from every other religion, from every other philosophy, from every other belief system in this world. There's no other ideology or religion, philosophy that has a person who died and rose again, with plenty of evidence for it. The suffering and death of Jesus predicted throughout the Old Testament, the Hebrew Bible, and by Jesus himself on many occasions, were the plan of God to redeem his people by atoning for the sins of the whole world. As we walked through Holy Week, we recounted the last events in Jesus' life before his death. A lot happened that week. He entered Jerusalem on Palm Sunday with the express purpose of confronting the corrupt Jewish leaders. He started by clearing out the temple. That certainly stirred up a hornet's nest. And then on Thursday night, he had supper with his disciples, which was quickly followed by his arrest and trial, his whipping, his crowning of thorns, and finally his crucifixion on Good Friday. Jesus was the true Passover lamb whose blood was shed for our sins. But the gospel story doesn't end with Jesus' death. It goes on to tell us of an event so strange, so miraculous, so wonderful, that its reality has changed the course of this world. It has changed the course of countless people's lives, of their hearts and minds. And that is the reality of Jesus' resurrection. Peter testified that he was one of those chosen by God to see Jesus alive. There were many who saw him on many occasions for 40 days until he ascended to the Father. In our gospel reading today, Peter did not see Jesus at the empty tomb. Mary Magdalene did. She was the first. And Jesus told her, "Go tell my apostles that I'm alive." And so later, it didn't take long for Jesus to appear to them. That evening, we read that trying to find my place. I think I got ahead of myself. Okay. In our gospel reading, Peter didn't see Jesus in the empty tomb, but he and the other disciple, who's thought to be John, went to the tomb and found it empty, except for the linen clothes that were lying where Jesus' body had been folded up. They didn't know what to think. They didn't understand that the scripture said that the Messiah must rise after 3 days. They didn't remember Jesus saying it to them on several occasions. But John, we read, went in and saw and believed. What did he see? He saw a tomb that had a body in it the last time they saw it. He saw linen cloths folded up where the body was. And it didn't make sense. I mean, grave robbers don't fold up the cloths neatly and put them where the body was, if that was what happened. What did he believe? Something. He didn't know exactly what had happened, but if being with Jesus for 3 years had taught him anything, it was that God was in complete control of everything that happened concerning Jesus. And he believed that somehow it wasn't over. God wasn't done with his only begotten Son. A spark of faith entered his heart. He couldn't imagine what was going on, but let me say this. He was excited to see what God was going to do next. It wasn't long before Jesus appeared to the disciples. We read that very evening that on the first day of the week, the doors were locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. I think that's probably an understatement. They were ecstatic. They were in shock. In one gospel, it says they disbelieved for joy. What a strange phrase. They disbelieved for joy. There he was standing before him, asking for something to eat so that he could show them that it was him. And then a week later, because Thomas wasn't there the first time, he literally appears to them again and says, "Thomas, put your hand in my wounds. See that it is I. Do not be disbelieving, but believe." And Thomas falls down and says, "My Lord and my God." And then we read about Peter and six others going fishing on the Sea of Tiberias and how Jesus appears to them. And we read about him ascending, going out as far as Bethany and ascending before them. And St. Paul writes years later that over 500 people saw Jesus at one time after he rose from the dead. He said, some of them are still alive. You can go find them. You can ask them. They were there. The fourth thing that Peter told his audience was that Jesus commanded us to preach and testify that he's the one appointed by God to be the judge of the living and dead and the dead. To him, all the prophets bear witness that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin through his name. Those who believe in Jesus are commanded to share this good news. It's not a suggestion. We're commanded to do so if we believe in him. We also are his witnesses, not of his physical resurrection 2,000 years ago, but of its reality, because we know that he's alive. He lives in us, he lives and works among us in his church. I'd like to return to Faria's story. A few years ago, she got another diagnosis.
In 2019, feeling like my throat wouldn't go away, I finally decided I needed to see a doctor. So I went to an ENT, and he said, oh, you're fine. You'd be hurting a lot more if you were really sick. Maybe just to be sure, go see the primary care physician. And I was very tentative. The receptionist gave me an appointment that afternoon, which was a shock to me. So I told the doctor when I saw her why I thought maybe I should see her after all, because my temperature was high and my weight was down 7 pounds and my blood pressure was low. And so she looked at me and she did a lot of some tests. She couldn't find anything, but she was upset that the ENT I'd seen did not do an endoscopy. So she said, I highly advise you to go and see another one. So I did. I went, called, made an appointment, but I was shocked again because I got an appointment the very next day. But I saw the ENT and he looked at my throat and he said, it's so swollen, I can't see anything. I'm going to give you some steroids and come back in 3 weeks. I was so much better in 3 weeks that I thought he was honestly going to tell me, go home, you're fine. But he gave me another endoscopy and they said, yeah, you've got cancer down there. And he said, you need to do something about it right away. If you don't, I give you 6 months. So he arranged for me to see an oncologist and a radiation person at Texas Tech, and they acted as if it would be a walk in the park, you know. So one third of the way through, I felt like I was gonna die. It was so painful. I couldn't eat, I couldn't drink water. For about 5 days, I was losing a pound a day. And finally, it was a Sunday afternoon, I said, dear God, I can't go on like this. How am I going to make it through if I'm losing a pound a day and I'm only a third of the way through? I said, I thought you wanted me to do this treatment from helping me find the cancer, but if you don't help me, I can't make it. The next morning, when I woke up, I felt completely different. It was just amazing. And from then on, I made it through the treatment. I survived it. A year later, they took scans and they decided it had metastasized down to my lungs, that I had spots on my lungs that I needed to get more treatment. So they gave me all kinds of chemo, immunotherapy, and I was bedridden for about almost all that entire summer. I finally stopped the treatment because I couldn't take it anymore. And they agreed to let me go to MD Anderson. So I went to MD Anderson and he said, I think they diagnosed that cancer incorrectly and that's why those treatments didn't work. But he said, it's a rare cancer. The only way we'll know is if we do a lung biopsy. I scheduled it, flew back to get it. They give you a whole slew of tests. The next morning before I got to the hospital for the biopsy, they called me and they said, we cannot do the biopsy because you just tested asymptomatic positive for COVID. So we can't do it. So they sent me home and they said, come back in 2 weeks. But that was like in late November and Christmas was coming up and I didn't want to come back in 2 weeks. So I scheduled it for end of January. And I thought, you know, I feel really good now. Why do I want to go and risk having a biopsy that might cause more problems? And they don't see, you know, they don't seem to be able to do anything anyway. Why go back? So I canceled it. And I know a lot of people think I'm a little crazy, but I'm just not that worried. I'm feeling good. I'm doing a lot of things that I want to do. I'm not worried about dying. And right now, I'm just going to kind of be excited to see what God's going to do.
So Faria's faith in the risen Lord is obvious. The reality of his presence has given her a heavenly perspective on life itself. Her life belongs to God. Her problems belong to God, not her. They're in his hands, not hers. She's not afraid to die. She believes in Jesus. She has received forgiveness as promised by him, and she waits to be with him in his kingdom. She's excited to see what God's going to do next in her life. What about, I'm going to get to this in a second. I said 5 points, there were four, but there is a fifth thing that happened when Peter was preaching. It says, while he was still speaking, the Holy Spirit fell on that household, Cornelius's friends and family. The Spirit of God came on them like on the day of Pentecost. And that's what happens when the gospel is preached. It's not just a guy quoting the Bible. It's the Holy Spirit working in people's hearts and telling them, you know this is true. You know it's true. So what about us? What are we facing in life? A physical illness or disability? The loss of employment? Maybe bankruptcy? A broken relationship? Maybe divorce? Betrayal? The loss of a loved one? Perhaps like many in our world today, you suffer from depression or anxiety or some form of trauma that you haven't been able to get over. Jesus is here today. He said, where two or three gather in my name, there I am. He has never failed in his promise to be present among those who believe in him. And he died for each one of us. He loves each one of us. He invites each one of us into his family. He wants to heal us and restore us in more than one way. Give your problems to Jesus and they won't be yours anymore. They'll be his. Give your life to Jesus and you won't need to worry about it. Your life will belong to him. He wants us to know him in that intimate way. I'd like to ask us all to pray, and you may pray aloud with me. Dear Father, Thank you for sending your son, Jesus, who loved me and gave himself up for me on a cross. I thank you that he's alive forevermore. And whether this is the very first time you've ever said these words or whether you've done it 1,000 times, we all need to continually give ourselves to him. So if you would pray with me, Jesus, I give you my life. I give you my problems. I give you my future. I want to belong to you. I want to be your son, your daughter, part of your family, part of the covenant. So I ask you to forgive me all my sins. Wash me clean through your blood and give me that miracle of a new birth that I may know you, that I may walk in this life with you in my heart and be with you for all eternity. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Cobb. Will you please stand with me? And let us affirm our faith in the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and a life for the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are found at in the bulletin on the bottom of page 4. And on this Easter Sunday, the congregation can confidently respond with the bolden words, "Risen Christ, give us new life in you." Hallelujah to our God who has given us the victory. Hallelujah to our God who has spoken, who has broken the power of death. Hallelujah to our God who has defeated the depths of darkness. Hallelujah to our God who has triumphed over evil. Hallelujah to our God. He has won for us life eternal. In love, we give ourselves to you, Holy Lord. In joy, we worship you, mighty Son of the Father. In you is our hope, O Christ. Lord, that we may rejoice in your resurrection. That we may know that you have conquered death.
Risen Christ,
that we may know that you have triumphed over the grave.
Risen Christ,
that those in doubt and despair may see your light.
Risen Christ,
that those who are troubled in mind may know your peace. That those in pain and distress may know your presence. That those caring for the eternally ill may know your power. And that those that mourn may discover the joy of life eternal.
Who in your great mercy made glad the disciples with the sight of the risen Lord, give us such knowledge of his presence with us that we may be strengthened and sustained by his risen life and serve you continually in righteousness and truth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Go ahead, take a seat, folks. I know there's a lot of excitement. You haven't seen each other since Christmas, I know. Go ahead, take a seat.
Good line.
So if you're new to the Church of St. Clement, welcome. We have an amazing announcement for you this morning. We're going to do this next Sunday, too. Yeah. As a matter of fact, every week we're going to do this. Yeah. However, the church is closed tomorrow. Please do not leave your cell phone, your earrings, your husband in the pews. They'll be here, trapped. On next Sunday, we have our breakfast, once a month breakfast at about 9:45, so you can come to the early service, or you can come early to the late service, which is at 10:45, and you can be there and meet people from both congregations, and it's a wonderful time of fellowship. So that's next Sunday at 9:45. Also, if you're not in our mailing list, let us know. If you think you give us your contact information, there's a form. If you think you're in our mailing list but you don't get our emails, check your spam, check your trash folder and your emails. Also, if you would like to be in our pictorial directory, and I hope if you're on our mailing list you would, send us a picture, a kind of a headshot, you know, not one from 100 yards away, you know, just close up of just you or you and your family, send it to Sarah, my assistant. Just get it to us. We'll get it in there digitally. Men of Christ will be on Wednesday, April 17th at 6 p.m., location TBA. Please RSVP to Father David Sheehan. And save the date for a family retreat on May 31st through June 2nd at Sacramento Camp and Conference Center. Esme, come on up and tell us about the women's retreat. Thank you. By the way, this service is being broadcast and will be recorded, and if you can share it with people after the service. You can share it with people. And it's stclements.com, stclements.com. Okay, we will have a prayer team in Easter Chapel, which is through these doors, or take a left at the altar rail during communion time. Do we have any birthdays or anniversaries to celebrate this Easter day? Okay, Emily, come on. Okay, got a few more. Okay, Kathy, come on. Young ladies, come on. Birthdays. Okay. Jennifer, come on, here we go. Another Jennifer, we got two Jennifers. Okay, Sophie. Oh, you're okay. She's Stuart. She doesn't look anything like Stuart. Okay. Let's pray. Watch over thy children, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace that passes all understanding abide all the days of their lives through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to pray for Jennifer and Stuart. Stuart's in Atlanta, probably watching. So let's pray. O God, you so bless the covenant of marriage that in it is represented the spiritual unity between Christ and his church. Send your blessing upon these your servants, O Lord, that their lives together may continue to reflect your love and forgiveness, and that their home may be a haven of blessing and peace. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Happy anniversary, Stuart and Jennifer.
Christ loved us and gave himself for us in offering and sacrifice to God.
I'm going to make one more instruction, and that is we have a lot of people in here, and so it works better if you could come up the side aisles, unless you're like with a walker or something, and you can come up the center one. But if come up the side aisles to communion, there'll be a station here and a station over there, or up at the altar rail, and then go back down the center aisle. It just works a little better when we have this kind of a crowd. But if you need to just go to the closest one, that's fine. Okay, thank you.
Sacrificial lamb, who bled for our healing. The scars are your perfect hands, the seal of new covenant. Through your suffering, death has lost its sting. You are and you always will be the Savior of the world. Everything for me, the one of heaven calls worthy, the Lamb, the Lion, the King. The body inside the grave, the spirit was warming. You stormed the accuser's gaze. The lion roaring, heir to the highest throne. The kingdom is yours alone. Through your victory, death has lost its sting. You are and you always will be the Savior of the world, who gave everything for me. The one of heaven. out the eastern gate for your coronation. All hail the one true King who reigns for eternity, and every living thing join their voice and sing. You are, and you always will be, the Savior of the world who is coming back for me. The Lord of the heaven calls worthy the Lamb, the Lion, and the King. Jesus, you are, and you always will be, the Savior of the world.
Just briefly before we get going, we welcome you. Actually, we encourage you to participate with us in this Holy Eucharist if you follow Jesus, and if you belong to him by faith, we want you to participate with us. And then if this is your first time here and you don't know what to do, just do what I did the first time I came, which is you cheat off your neighbor. You can't mess it up. No one will get mad at you. The Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who is offered for us and has taken away the sin of the world, who by his death has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
holy, and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you, in your mercy, sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took the bread. I lost it. Boom. Where is it? Oh, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also, that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to sing. Christ, our Passover, has been sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
God, the Prince of Peace, a child to us is born.
Behold the Lamb of God, who takes away our sin. Behold the Lamb of God, the life and light of men. Behold the Lamb of God, who died and rose again. Behold the Lamb of God, who comes to take away.
I know the author of tomorrow is born. All my life. Thank you.
Let us pray.
Eternal God,
Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Before we have the final blessing, I'd like to thank everyone who makes Holy Week and Easter so very special, for Trey, our organist, for Ron Gillis, our past choir director, who came all the way from Dallas to do this with us. Yeah. For Ben, who's our new choir director, for the brass, for our timpani, for the altar guild, for the flower guild, for our acolytes and our ushers and our basically behind the scenes people who do everything, for the praise band, for Rick Milliron, for our clergy. So if I left you out, I'm sorry. But anyway, for you, for coming. Thank you.
All of our problems,
we send to the cross of Christ.
All of our difficulties,
we send to the cross of Christ.
All the devil's works,
we send to the cross of Christ.
And all of our hopes,
we send to the risen Christ.
And may God Almighty, who has redeemed us and made us his children through the resurrection of his Son, our Lord, bestow upon you the riches of his blessing.
Amen.
May God, who through the water of baptism has raised us from sin into newness of life, make you holy and worthy to be united with Christ forever.
Amen.
May God, who has brought us out of bondage to sin into true and lasting freedom in the Redeemer, bring you to your eternal inheritance.
Amen.
And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forever.
Spirit to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.
Alleluia.